Now let us talk about the bending failure of cotter. Okay, now this is the cotter. I have drawn it horizontally because I am going to treat this cotter as a simply supported beam. So first of all, let us determine the portion of cotter present in the socket and spigot. Now if you look at this diagram, the portion of or length of cotter present in the spigot is D2, because D2 is the diameter of this spigot. So middle portion of cotter is present in the spigot and it is having length D2. So let us write this middle portion of cotter. This middle portion of cotter having length D2. So D2 is the length of this cotter which is present in this spigot. Now let us talk about the length of cotter present in the socket. Now if you consider that this cotter is in contact with the socket from this point to this point. Again, I will repeat, the cotter, it is in contact with the socket from this point to this point. So we have to determine the length of cotter present in the socket between these two points. Okay, but this middle region of cotter is present in the spigot. So we have to consider the effective length of cotter present in the socket is the addition of this portion with this portion. So these are the two portions of cotter present in the socket. Now this is the collar of socket having diameter D4. So D4 is the diameter of socket collar, that is distance between these two points is D4, and distance between these two points is D2. Okay, so if you subtract this D2 from this D4, that is this D4, so we get the addition of these two segments. Okay, so this segment is nothing but the length of bottom portion of cotter present in the socket, and this segment represents the length of cotter present in the socket. Okay, so this segment is nothing but D4 minus D2 upon 2, and this segment is nothing but D4 minus D2 upon 2. Okay, so let us write this. So I have written here the middle portion of cotter is present in the spigot, and the length of cotter present in the spigot is D2, which is equal to diameter of spigot, and these two portions are present in the socket and having the length D4 minus D2 upon 2 and D4 minus D2 upon 2 respectively. Now let us talk about the forces acting on cotter. So as we discussed, this middle portion of cotter is present in the spigot and which is subjected to force P. So this force P is nothing but the force exerted by this spigot on this cotter, and this top and bottom portion of this cotter is present in this socket. Okay, so socket exerts force P by 2 and force P by 2 at top region and at bottom region of this cotter. Okay, so just we have to represent these forces in this cotter that I have drawn here. But while drawing this, while showing these forces, we have to just make one assumption that the force exerted by this spigot on this cotter, we have to assume as a UDL, and force exerted by this socket on this cotter, we have to assume as a UVL. Okay, so UDL is nothing but the uniformly distributed load, and UVL is nothing but the uniform varying load. So again, I will repeat, the force exerted by spigot on this cotter, we have to assume as a UDL, and the force exerted by this socket on these two portions of cotter, we have to assume as a UVL. So let us show this UDL and UVL forces on this cotter. So as I discussed earlier, the forces exerted by socket on this cotter, I have represented by P by 2 as a UVL, and force exerted by spigot on this cotter, I have represented as a UDL of magnitude P. Okay, but if you look at this cotter, so it has one center line which divides the effective length of cotter into two parts. Okay, and that center line can be drawn from the here. So this center line divides this effective length of this cotter, the effective length in the sense the length of cotter which is subjected to external force, and this length is subjected to, this total length is subjected to some kind of external loading, and this length is called as effective length of cotter, and this is the center line of this cotter. Now, in order to have the symmetry of forces with respect to the center line, we have to divide the single UDL of magnitude P into two UDLs of magnitude P by 2, P by 2 each. Okay, again I will repeat, this is a single UDL. Okay, and this is a center line of this effective length of quarter, and we have to show the symmetry of forces with respect to the center line of quarter. So we have to divide this single UDL of magnitude P into two UDLs of each magnitude P by 2 and P by 2. So for the single UDL of P, the base is D2. So if we make this single UDL into two UDLs, the base will also divide into two parts, that is D2 by 2 and D2 by 2. So let us show this. Now let us convert this UDL into point load. So first consider this half UDL. So this half UDL having magnitude P by 2 and its base is D2 by 2. So it will act, this UDL will act at the center of this base D2 by 2. Okay. So it will act at this point. This is the force P by 2, it is the point load for this half UDL, and its distance, it will divide this base D2 by 2 into two parts. Okay. So this point load P by 2 of for this UDL, it will divide this base D2 by 2 into two parts. So this base will be D2 upon 4 and D2 upon 4. Okay. Similarly, we can do for this half UDL P by 2, but let us consider only half portion for this conversion of UDL and UL into point load. Now let us convert this UL into point load, and as we know that this UL, its point load will act at a distance of 1/3 of base from maximum intensity. So maximum intensity is here and its base is D4 minus D2 upon 2. So this point load P by 2 for this UVL will act 1/3 of base from this maximum intensity. So we can show this force here having magnitude P by 2, and this distance, that is the distance from maximum intensity, it is 1/3 of this base, and base is D4 minus D2 upon 2. So this distance is D4 minus D2 upon 6. Now I have shown here the point load for this UVL as a P by 2, and it will act from this maximum intensity, that is from this point, at 1/3 of base, and base is D4 minus D2 upon 2. So this distance is 1/3 of base D4 minus D2 upon 2, that is D4 minus D2 upon 6. Now from this center line of this quarter, the forces are P by 2, which is nothing but a point load for this half UDL, and this P by 2 force, which is nothing but the point load for this UVL. Now, as there is a symmetricity with respect to the center line, we can show these two forces on the left side also, and the distances are same from the center line. So as I have explained on the RHS of this center line, on the LHS also I have shown this conversion of this half UDL of magnitude P by 2 into point load P by 2. For this half UDL, the base is D2 by 2, and this point load will act at the center of this D2 by 2. Thus, this total base D2 by 2 will get divided into two parts, that is D2 upon 4 and D2 upon 4. Similarly, this UVL, we have to convert it into point load. So I have shown here this force P by 2 as a point load for this UVL, and it will act at 1/3 of this maximum intensity. So that is from this point, that is from this point, the distance between this maximum intensity and this force point load is 1/3 of base, that is D4 minus D2 upon 6, as I explained here. Now let us find out the bending moment. As we know that this we can treat as a simply supported beam. So maximum bending moment will occur at the center of this effective length. Let us write this point as OO, and the bending moment, maximum bending moment, will occur at this point O. So let us find out this maximum bending moment. So now let us find out the maximum bending moment, and maximum bending moment is at center of effective length, that is point O. So point O is the center point of effective length of this quarter. Effective length in the sense the length of quarter which is subjected to some kind of external loading, and the length between these two points is nothing but the length, effective length of this quarter which is subjected to some kind of external loading. So let us find out this maximum bending moment, which is denoted by MB. Now consider only the half portion either left or right to this center line. So let us consider the right portion to this center line. Okay, so first consider this force P by 2. So now the bending moment of this P by 2 with respect to point O is anticlockwise. Let us take this anticlockwise bending moment as positive. So force is P by 2 and distance is, this distance is d4 minus d2 upon 6. And from this point to this point, distance is d2 upon 2 plus d2 upon 2. So this is the bending moment because of this force P by 2. So P by 2 into this distance, d4 minus d2 upon 6 plus this point to this point, distance is d2 upon 2. Now if you consider this second force P by 2, because of this force P by 2, the bending moment is clockwise, which we have to take negative. So minus P by 2 into this distance is d2 upon 4. Now let us simplify this. If you simplify this, you can get the equation like this. So after simplification, you will get the maximum bending moment MB as P upon 2 into bracket d4 upon 6 plus d2 upon 12. Now let us find out the bending stress. Now consider this is the cross section for this quarter having mean width as B and thickness T. So with this diagram, we have to find out the moment of inertia I and Y. So first of all, let us put the value of this MB. So MB is P upon 2, d4 upon 6 plus d2 upon 12 upon I is TB cube upon 12 into Y is B upon 2. And if you simplify this, you will get the final equation of bending stress as. So after simplification, you will get this equation as P upon 2 into bracket d4 upon 6 plus d2 upon 12 upon TB square upon 6. So I have cancelled here one B and this 12 upon 2 is a 6. So in this way, I have obtained this equation. Now in this equation, sigma B is nothing but the induced bending stress in this quarter. P is nothing but the external applied force. D4 is the diameter of socket collar. D2 is the diameter of spigot. T is the thickness of this quarter and B is the mean width of quarter. So this equation of sigma B is used to find out the bending stress in the quarter, because of which the bending failure of quarter takes place.